It's not Superman, it's Superior Man.
The Overcoming Man. That sounds really weird. I can't believe I just said that.
All right, welcome back, welcome back. We have our special guest, Sean, with us here today. A really acclaimed writer, coach. He has an extremely successful podcast in Taiwan right now. My good friend, Sean, thank you for being here with us here today. You are coming up with new theories to help people discover themselves as well. Is that right? Can you tell us about what you're working on recently?
Well, I re-entered psychology after several years in doing media.
Yeah.
And I discovered positive psychology.
What's that?
Which actually wasn't available even as a subject to study back when I was in graduate school.
Okay.
It's a relatively new thing in psychology, which really is the scientific way of looking at a meaningful life. What makes a life worth living? That's the ultimate question of positive psychology. And there are several ways of looking at it, but one of the main ways that I'm interested in is meaning making.
Okay.
Right? How do we make meaning out of our lives?
Wow.
And you know, there's a lot of different theories, but my theory is that we make meaning based on how we look back on the story of our lives. Okay. And I guess based on what we had just shared, it's no surprise of why I would go that route, right? Because of what I went through, of where my story was told countless numbers of times in a way that I didn't really feel ownership to. But then eventually that became my reality and I had to re-author myself. Mm-hmm. I was basing myself off of that, but then trying to build something off of that. And that whole experience led me to believe in the power of realizing what you might mean to the world based on connecting the dots of what happened earlier in your life.
Okay, but there's a book that you mentioned, I read somewhere that you're reading right now. It's The Power of Moments. Is that something along the line of what you were just talking about?
Oh yeah, Chip and Dan Heath. Well, that book is about creating significant moments, right, in the here and now. And we all talk about these fleeting moments that we want to capture. And most of us really, now, the reflexive action is just to take out our phones and try to capture the moment. But when we are looking at the moment through a screen, we lose the impact of the moment. We're really
We miss the moment.
Yeah, we're outsourcing our memory actually to a device.
Yeah.
With really, and seriously, you know, how many people really capture the moment and then go back and look at it?
Right.
Like really, really enjoy it, right? Or savor that moment.
Yeah.
And I think by intentionally budgeting the time and creating those significant moments, we can anchor our lives in a very meaningful way. Now that's going forward, but there's also another way of looking backward where we look at things that have happened to us, significant at the moment or maybe insignificant, but they might connect in a way where you suddenly realize, whoa, this has been almost meant to be all along. And things that might have sucked at that moment turns out to be one of the greatest gifts to my life because it caused my life to change. And I think that is a beautiful moment because you can actually, you can, you know, overcome a lot of traumas. You can redefine who you are, mm-hmm. right? You can redefine your identity.
Yep.
And I think doing that would make for a much healthier person. So I've taken it upon myself in my own little part of the world by holding these workshops and through my podcast, et cetera, to try to help people to make better meaning out of their lives.
Oh, that's wonderful. I understand you just wrapped up a session.
Oh, yes,
a course. What's the workshop about? Tell us about that.
That workshop is actually a men's workshop.
Okay.
Yeah, purely for men. Which most people find very hard to believe. Right. And I'm actually wearing a pin.
Well, obviously, the men's workshop. You gotta have a pin.
You have a pin, but you only get it at the end. You get it at the end. So you can see that this is, it actually looks like, looks like the steering wheel on the ship.
Okay.
Yeah, and it represents the different areas of life. Uh-huh. So a man's work, life is.
We need that. Derek, you might need to go to that workshop. We've been worried about that for a while now.
What's the next meeting?
to turn. Coming up soon. I'll tell you all about it.
Yeah.
We do need a band.
Yeah.
we need some musicians.
Yeah. to turn boys into men or no? No. So what is a men's workshop?
Well, actually, it's interesting. You say, do we turn boys into men? Well, it's more of kind of like we reawaken the boy inside the man. The boy that has never really gotten the good hearing. The boy that's always been misunderstood. The boy where, every time they try to say something, they try to understand something, they've been told, be quiet, shut up. In Asian culture, this happens a lot. Mm. The boy who a lot of times really wants to love, but then is being asked to love in a different way because that's the way that filial piety says that you ought to act. And, imagine having a curated self in that sense.
Yeah.
Right? So it's all about really kind of asking yourself, well, what do I want out of life? And most men, we're very goal-oriented. Mm-hmm. So we chase after, business goals. And we have our own, maybe we go and sign up for a marathon, mm-hmm. right? And we have our family to take care of.
Yep.
But how about ourselves? How about what do I really want, from life? And each one of us comes into this life with a different mission.
Yep.
And I truly believe that. And by discovering that and finding that alignment between, what you really aspire to be, or who you really aspire to be, and what your ambitions are, and your daily actions, that we can really become a congruent person.
Oh, wow. But that's a million-dollar question right there. I just had this conversation literally with someone last night.
Yeah.
Is, figuring out what you really want. And my friend's narrative or opinion was, life is so simple. As long as you figure out what you want, then you go after it. But my point was, easier said than done.
Yes.
It's really hard to figure out what you want. There are many people, I feel, in today's society, they're frustrated. It's first of all, you got to get rid of what's frustrating you. It's this. It's that. It's a layers and layers and combination. It's a little bit of this and a little bit of that. So that's probably giving you a certain amount of frustration. But then, if you can at least sort through that, you can get through the weeds of that. Then it's working on your project or your bonsai tree, or that's what do you envision? So what does make you happy? But to find that image, it's not as easy as it seems.
Well, when you talk about being stuck in the weeds, right? A lot of guys just think, well, I'm going to break out the weed cutter, and I will just clear out all the weeds first, right? But the weeds grow much faster than you can cut.
Right.
Right. You do need that perspective, and every once in a while, you need to give yourself that perspective or that time to really think about things.
That's wonderful.
And you slow down. You journal. You read through your journals. You discover themes. And sometimes you do need someone to coach you along with it and to help you to find the meaning within it, to help you connect the dots, so to speak. And in a way, I'm very happy that my father actually did that for me. He threw down these anchor points, right? These little tidbits that were so insignificant in my life that he thought was significant and somehow millions of other readers thought was significant. And they became something that actually became a source of meaning for me. And for a while, I have to be honest, for a while I rebelled against it. I didn't take ownership of that. And I think, wait a second, that's only part of the story. But then as I got older, I realized this is something that's very valuable because this has become a part of all of us. This has become part of our collective memory.
Yep.
And if so, how can I build upon that? How can I build upon that so I can serve more people so that I can help everybody to self-author their own lives.
That is wonderful. So this is called the Superman Workshop. What is it called in English?
Well, it actually doesn't have a technical English term right now because we haven't rolled it out in English. But I guess I would probably say it would be the so-called Superior Man.
Okay.
And I know that sounds a little bit, a little you egotistical.
Guys, you laughed when I said Superman? It's not Superman. It's Superior Man.
But it's, I guess the
it's kind of like the cheesy translation. It's a little more beyond.
I don't think there's it's a very tough word to translate. You know, it's a very hard thing to really talk about, even because, in Chinese.
Because in Chinese, I believe the word has more meaning of surpassing or thriving
or
achieving.
Exactly. Overcoming. Overcoming.
Yeah, something like that.
So
right?
It's the overcoming man. That sounds really weird. Can't believe I just said that.
Somehow I feel like suddenly we're gonna have a massive flood of signups.
Wow, it's only noon here.
Yeah, leave your comments below on that part. And sorry to the person that's subtitling this episode.
As long as we can keep it up, and as long as we're really trying to build up a system where we can teach other men to do the same. Okay. So we actually right now we have 35 groups that are completely, you know, organic, that have just sprouted up all over Taiwan, and it's completely free to join. And it happens on Friday nights, right? After dinner, a group of men get together and they share stories about themselves. And it revolves around maybe one certain story that we pick out, right? But then everyone else shares. And through that sharing, we've actually had a lot of healing. We've had a lot of great feedback from men. And it definitely beats your standard pub conversation, which usually revolves around what's going on TV or what's going on in the world or in the stock market. You know, let's get away from that external part and really kind of look a little bit inside ourselves. I think we're at that junction, you know, where we really have to, there's so much going on the outside to distract us.
Already. All right, so for the general audience out there that has not had a chance to join one of your sessions, or maybe planning to join, but watching this today, I mean, there's a lot of men out there. Men are, for the majority of the part, men are less verbal, less expressive about their feelings.
Yes.
So some frustrations are just, you know, bottled up. Any simple tips or advice for them for the time being before they can really actually have a chance to join one of these sessions?
Well, I would say first, the best way, first of all, is to keep a journal, a written journal.
Okay.
Right. And write down your feelings and your thoughts and your actions, but separate them into three separate columns, right? What happened today? How did I feel about it? What did I think? And then what did I do? And by separating them into the separate columns, you may start to see some patterns. Most of us actually just write as a stream of consciousness. And then it's very easy to go circular. So by using this very simple form of journal keeping, you can actually start to discover something about yourself. And everyone can do that, you know, in your own home. And once you start doing that for a while and you discover, okay, there are these patterns, then find somebody to talk to about it. You know, you can find your loved one, right? Someone that you trust, right? Your good buddy. And if you're in Taiwan, welcome to look us up.
Yeah. All right. You're still obviously someone that cherishes and studying and projecting, you know, maybe some of the things that we should be watching out for, or how do we navigate? Are your kids online?
Yes,
your kids
of course.
Using, you know, chat? Okay.
Oh yeah, they're using all the
All right.
In fact, you know, legally obliged to actually supervise them, right? And so I do check in with, you know, what they look at every once in a while, and I have conversations with them, right? Also, you know, they have their own little chat groups and all that, and I try not to peek in there because I don't want to really meddle in their business. But one day, because my son's phone is locked to my account, so I accidentally went in there and I was just surprised. Wow, I guess I shouldn't be surprised. I mean, this is just like schoolyard language, right?
Yeah. Well, I don't know how many, I hear this all the time, many parents are accidentally logged into their kid's account. Is that a real accident?
But
for me, I'm not as liberal or as you are. For me, it's definitely a full censorship in our house.
Oh yeah.
So yeah, I need to have access to your phone when I ask.
Uh-huh.
And if you don't, I pay for the cellular service. I can cut it off next month.
Okay.
All right. So so far, I've been getting away with that.
And so you know, you've been okay with what you've been seeing, or do you actually do monitor?
No, once they get older, I hold the right to check.
Yeah.
But I kind of try to respect not checking.
Oh, well, you know, we see the act of supervising as trying to help them develop the digital literacy so that one day when they're out on their own, they're not going to get, you know, scammed.
So what did you do, about the schoolyard language that you saw?
Well, I saw some things about kids complaining about their parents or about the teacher or whatnot, right? Using some language that was a little disrespectful. I thought that was natural. And I happened to be
being so mild with the way you describe this. I think back in our days, it would have been much rougher
with our parents.
Well, anything.
I think it would have made it into a chapter of one of these books.
That's the first thing.
Yes.
And for me, I was.
So what did you do?
Okay, I happened to be having a conversation with my daughter during that day about digital literacy and about searching online.
Okay.
She was giving me a little bit of an attitude, right? Because she didn't really want to be there. She had her homework to do and all that, her friends to hang out with. And I said, no, this is very important. You know, we want to sit down. Daddy wants to teach you some things, right? About how to separate, you know, fact from fiction and how to authenticate sources and blah, blah, blah. And she was there like, yeah, whatever. And I just remember, you know, seeing what was in some of the chat groups and the things that maybe she had said about me. And I said, okay, you know what? Why don't we do a Google search about why is my dad so annoying?
Okay. All right.
And really? she kind of froze in her tracks. So she looked at me and like, are you serious, Dad? I said, yeah, just do that. Okay. Let's just do that. Right? And then, okay, so out pops a whole bunch of things, right? There were some YouTube videos, you know, and then there was some like, you know, WikiHows and all that kind of stuff. And I said, okay, now, which one do you think is a source that you would trust, right? And she picked out the one that was more sort of, you know, academic or more, you know, official in nature. And I said, but if you were really pissed off at me, if you're really annoyed at me, right, that little YouTuber video right there about the one thing, the one sentence that you can say to your parents that's going to shut him up, right, are you going to be looking at that video? And she says, well, yes. I said, really? So what actually we do when we search online is we look for information that we want to look for.
Yeah. Right? Yes.
Yeah. And so from there, we then evolved very naturally into that whole subject of digital literacy. But if I had confronted her and just said, well, you know, I find your attitude to be a problem, and I find you, or do you think I'm annoying right now? She would go on the defensive. And I think the lesson will be over.
Right.
And hopefully years from now, you know, they're going to look back and they're going to look back on these moments with fondness.
Yes.
You know, of all these different times, including maybe the fantastic vacations or the great meals.
Yes.
But it's these moments where, you know, daddy or mommy actually took the time and sat down and talked to me.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And we really listened to each other.
Yes.
Those are the moments that matter.
Well, currently, Sean's got a men's workshop. He's got the podcast going on from 200 moving toward 300 mark episode. You do have a collab book out right now, but unfortunately, that's only in Mandarin. Also talking about positive identity as well.
Well, it's narrative. Life narrative.
Okay.
And we hope to empower people through this book. And this book has five authors.
Uh-huh.
Actually, one of whom is a guest on this show.
Andre. Yes, Andre.
Andre Chang.
Yeah.
And the five of us have donated all of our royalties and proceeds from the book to the charities of our choice, including the publisher themselves.
Okay.
So this is one of those books where we just hope to share with the world.
And the name of the book is?
The name of the book is The Meaning of the Time Between Life and Death. That's the English name.
Oh, wow. Okay, beautiful. All right, so you have a number of things going on, but I'm still glad you squeezed in some time for us to have this moment here.
Always a pleasure.
Together. Dennis. All right, we got to have you back next time. And once again, thank you for coming.
Thank you.
And I'll see you around, okay?
All right, next
Thanks,
time,
Sean.
I have my kids.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.